Hey folks, this is Sebastian, and I'm here today with our PhD students, Maria and Johannes. And we're here today at Toverland near Venlo in the Netherlands to do some smartphone experiments
on a roller coaster.
Okay, so the idea is that we use our free and open source app phyphox to record some acceleration and pressure data on the roller coasters, specifically Phoenix, and let's see if we can interpret the data.
In principle, you can directly select the accelerometer or pressure sensor in phyphox, but when doing these experiments on a fast ride, there is a catch. We have to follow safety rules. Usually, you are not allowed to hold your phone in your hand, as it might seriously injure you or other guests. The rules that have been set by the park and its staff are there for a reason, so please follow them. Luckily, you are allowed to carry your phone in your pocket on most roller coasters, so that's where we have to measure the ride. But to do so, we have to prepare a few things. You absolutely do not want to accidentally trigger anything on your screen during the ride, but you cannot simply turn off the screen since phyphox needs to remain active. But it can use the proximity sensor of your phone to disable the screen while it is measuring in your pocket. To do so, go to the app settings from the app's main screen, look for proximity lock and enable it. You will not notice a difference at first, but whenever a measurement is running, phyphox will turn off the screen as soon as anything gets close to the proximity sensor, like the inside of your pocket. The next problem is the orientation of your phone. If you want to understand the data you recorded, you need to know the orientation of your coordinate axis. But if it's in your pocket, the phone will be at a rather weird angle. To make your life a bit easier, scan this QR code from the plus menu in phyphox to load a configuration that tries to automatically adjust the coordinate axis. You can save it in your experiment collection, so you can just open it from the main screen without scanning any QR codes in the future. This configuration has a countdown enabled by default, and when the measurement starts, it will use the first data points to determine the direction of gravity and adjust the coordinate axis such that the z-axis points up. This means that you have to start the experiment, put it in your pocket while the countdown is running, and assume the exact position in your seat that you will have during the ride. If you need to change the countdown duration, you can do so in the menu in the top right corner. Also, be aware that phyphox can only determine the direction of down, but it is not aware of which direction is forward. So try to point the y-axis, that is the long side of your phone, along the forward direction. One last tip, if you have to wait in line before the ride, use that time to do a test run in your pocket. Losing the data is particularly annoying if you have to wait a long time before riding again. Everything ready? Then let's see what we get. Wait, sorry, but this motion already looks rather complicated. How about we let Maria and Johannes go through a few basic motions first, and we come back to the Phoenix roller coaster later.
Are you serious? This is what I get to talk about. Yeah, well, whatever. So, most roller coasters will do turns from time to time, and the most basic version of a turn is a circular motion. And you can check that out right here on a merry-go-round like this.
You might think at first that there's not much going on while sitting on a merry-go-round. But let's look at it from above and remember Newton's laws of motion. Without any external forces, a body remains in motion at a constant speed in a straight line. So, in order for you to move on a circle instead of a straight line, the merry-go-round, or, well, the horse you're sitting on, exerts a force on you towards the center of the circle. This is called centripetal force, and it leads to centripetal acceleration, which we can measure. This merry-go-round here is not particularly fast, so the vibrations on the orange z-axis are the first thing we see. But if we look at the other axes, we can clearly see that the forward-facing blue y-axis is barely affected, while the green x-axis shows a clear negative signal, which is an acceleration pointing towards the center. The centripetal acceleration. But of course, we can also experience acceleration without a turn. I think Maria has found a good example for that.
Oh,
Since Phoenix turns and drops right at the beginning, let's have a look at the much simpler motion at first, at least from a physics point of view. This is a launch roller coaster, so we are accelerated along a single axis. Let's go for it!
The launch of this coaster is a perfect example for a simple linear acceleration. At the moment, you are seeing noise on all three axes from small vibrations and a little jerk from the brakes. Let's see what happens next. This really is the most basic example for acceleration. It only happens along one axis, which in this case is the y-axis. And indeed, when the coaster accelerates forwards, we can clearly see that on the blue y-axis and barely anything on x and z, until the track rises and things get more complicated. But that's enough about acceleration. There's another sensor in our phones that might be interesting to us.
So far, we've only been looking at the acceleration data. However, if your smartphone has got a pressure sensor, you can use that to also record altitudes. And what better place to play with altitudes than a drop tower?
No. The pressure sensor will measure the atmospheric pressure, and it's sensitive enough to resolve the small pressure changes that occur with altitude. If you go up, the pressure goes down, and phyphox can calculate the difference in altitude. Unfortunately, there are a few technical details to discuss here. First of all, not all phones have that sensor. In that case, you won't get any altitude data, but you can still measure the acceleration with your accelerometer. Or you might notice that your pressure sensor is rather noisy, like in this example here. This is often the case with phones that are waterproof, as the pressure inside the phones cannot equalize as fast with the pressure outside. In this case, even touching the phone can lead to small pressure changes inside that dominate your measurements. Other phones might have a much smaller sampling rate. For example, Apple devices only offer about one measurement per second. Averaging of fast, noisy data here, in blocks of 1 second each, as shown by the red line, should be similar to what to expect on an iPhone. Okay, now I think we're finally ready for the roller coaster.
Let's first watch the entire ride, shall we? You might want to pause and review some parts, as there's a lot going on. After the ride, we will have a look at some specific parts. Alright, let's review some parts that match what we discussed earlier in the video. Phoenix starts with a drop, and of course, this is the most pronounced change in altitude during the entire ride, and we can clearly see it in the altitude data from our pressure sensor. Then there is a banked curve. Just like on the merry-go-round, we barely see any acceleration along the blue forward-pointing y-axis, as it goes at a nearly constant speed. But the centripetal acceleration of that curve is well visible on the other axis. In contrast to the merry-go-round, the acceleration is now distributed along X and Z as the coaster leans into the curve, which rotates our coordinate system. And finally, we get the simple linear acceleration only during the brake at the end of the ride. Braking is just an acceleration against the direction you are going, so we see this as a negative acceleration on the blue forward-pointing y-axis. With that knowledge, you can now go on any roller coaster and interpret its motion. Well, at least if your coordinate axis stays aligned with the track. For this one here, with rotating cards, we might also need the phone's gyroscope. But maybe that's for another video. Okay, so that's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it as much as we did making it. Thanks to Professor Anne-Marie Pendril, who gave us a lot of tips on how to do these experiments on the rides. Of course, a big thank you to Toverland, who allowed us to shoot here. If you want to learn more about phyphox and maybe some experiments we can do with it, check out phyphox.org or just check out our YouTube channel. Also, if you want to help us, you can check out phyphox.org/contribute, where we have a list of things that would really help us. All the links are in the video description. I hope we see you soon in an upcoming video. See you then.